Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Genius of Israel. The Surprising Resilience of a Divided Nation in a Turbulent World. By Dan Senor and Saul Singer. Read by Dan Senor.
To my mother, Helen Senor, who taught me about resilience through every chapter of her story, Dan Senor. To my father, Max Singer, who taught me the craft of thinking differently. To my mother, Suzanne Singer, who taught me how to live joyously, Saul Singer. We are forever grateful that the life journeys of Helen, Max, and Sue led them to Israel. Author's note. As this book goes to press in the summer of 2023, Israel is embroiled in a conflict, not against external foes, but within itself. For 6 months and counting, Israelis have come out to the streets by the hundreds of thousands in a struggle over the fundamental structure of Israel's government. As we discuss in Chapter 10, The Wars of the Jews, Israeli and Jewish history is ridden with internal conflicts. In that chapter, we attempt to place the current conflict over Israel's judicial system into historical context. Here in this note, we feel obliged to address a different question. As a core theme of this book, that one of Israeli society's great strengths is its sense of solidarity, belonging, and caring for the country, been overtaken by events? Political polarization is on the rise in many Western democracies. There are numerous studies chronicling this trend. According to the 2023 Edelman Trust Barometer, surveying over 32,000 people in 28 countries, majorities in 15 of those countries believed that their countries were more divided today than in the past. Three Western countries, U.S., Spain, and Sweden, were found to be severely divided. The heated events of 2023 show that Israel is not immune to this global trend. So how is Israel different? The difference is that Israel has a reservoir of social solidarity that it can draw upon. There is an ideal of solidarity that, even if sometimes honored in the breach, is a powerful aspiration across the political spectrum. One stunning finding of the Edelman survey was that less than one-third of respondents said they would help someone in need with whom they strongly disagree politically. Only one-fifth said they would be willing to live in the same neighborhood with a political opponent or have them as a co-worker. In Israel, to even ask these questions would be strange. Disagreeing with gusto is not only normal, but central. Nor can Israelis avoid engaging across tribal lines. The country is too small and families are too large. Extended families often include religious and secular members. Marriages between Ashkenazi and Mizrahi Jews are common, so families also blend across this divide. People with starkly opposing views live not just in the same neighborhood, but also in the same apartment buildings, and often sit around the same Shabbat dinner table. And then there is, of course, military service, which for a majority of Israelis is the most powerful melting pot of all. Often in this book, when we refer to Israelis or Israeli society, we have in mind the approximate two-thirds of Israelis who may be ethnically, economically, religiously, and ideologically diverse, but this majority still does not include Haredi, ultra-Orthodox Jews, or Israeli Arabs. While Israel's two largest minorities are slowly becoming more intertwined with broader society, by and large they live in separate worlds. See Chapter 11, The Other Israel. But these three worlds are more interconnected than it seems, and there's a complex interplay between the forces that are bringing them together and prying them apart. The gaps between Israelis are real. The two-thirds majority, the ultra-Orthodox minority, and the Israeli-Arab minority generally, though not always, live separately and study in separate school systems. But it wouldn't occur to an Israeli not to help someone in need because they disagreed politically. Jews and Arabs are literally saving one another's lives daily in hospitals and through emergency services, as we also discuss in Chapter 11. But solidarity cannot be built just on daily interactions or a high tolerance for arguing. Solidarity must stand on something profound that is shared, and Jewish Israelis share a common story and fate. For Israelis, united we stand, divided we fall is not just a cliché, it's reality. Israelis know that if their common bond is shattered, their country will cease to exist. In other polarized countries, the yearning for unity that cuts across deep political divides might not be as strong. You can't yearn for what you can't imagine. In Israel, the solidarity is just beneath the surface, like a frame holding a mosaic together. One evening, at the height of the protests over judicial reform, the long escalators going down into the Jerusalem station for the train to Tel Aviv were packed with protesters, many of them carrying Israeli flags. On that day, the main pro-government rally was in Tel Aviv, while the main anti-government protest was in Jerusalem, opposite the Knesset, Israel's parliament. After the rallies, the up escalators were filled with government supporters returning to Jerusalem, while the down escalators were packed with government opponents returning to Tel Aviv. Spontaneously, people started stretching across the wide divider between the escalators to shake hands with their opponents. A video of the scene went viral and became an instant icon. In the video, a young bandana-wearing protester reached across. His sign turned toward the other escalator. The sign read, "Equality, Justice, Democracy." As he was shaking hand after hand, he shouted, "I love you. You don't know how much I love you." In Israel, such a scene is not surprising. It is reflective of a culture that celebrates disagreement and lionizes unity. In other politically divided countries, the shaking hand scene would be unimaginable, partly because the two sides don't rub shoulders and partly because there's no sense of an underlying bond. When Israelis look back at this time, they will remember the bitterness and the passions. But we hope they will also remember the hands reaching across the escalators. Much of this book is about what brings Israelis together, as well as what pushes them apart. The unifying forces should not be taken for granted. That these forces have withstood so many tests is a miracle, and miracles take a lot of work to maintain. Israel isn't a paragon of democracy, because it cannot be, writes Yossi Klein Halevi. But Israel is a paragon of the struggle for democratic norms under near impossible circumstances, as many episodes in Israeli history demonstrate. Israel is a laboratory for democracy under extremity, and that is its value for the world. Dan Senor, New York City, and Saul Singer, Jerusalem. August 1st, 2023. Introduction. The Israeli Paradox. Humans don't mind hardship. In fact, they thrive on it. What they mind is not feeling necessary. Modern society has perfected the art of making people not feel necessary. Sebastian Younger. Tiffany Wen lay on the massage mat. It was that brief moment when you were there alone, waiting for the masseur you had met a moment ago to return. Wen thought, should I tell him? Or would that be out of place? Or would he mention it on his own? He didn't. She didn't like to point things out to people. But if she didn't, she knew that the niggling thought would be there. Better to get it out and over with. I'm sure you remember, but the siren is going to go off in the middle of our massage, she said, speaking to the wall, the side of her face nestling into the towel covering the mat. Oh yeah, today is Yom HaZikaron, he said, conscious of the role reversal. As the Israeli in the room, he should have been doing the reminding. It was Memorial Day, when Israel remembers its fallen soldiers. When the siren goes off, he said, recovering his authority, you just lie on the mat. Don't worry about getting up in the middle of your massage. But I'll stop and stand during the siren. Wen, an Asian-American journalist from San Francisco who had followed her Israeli boyfriend back to Tel Aviv, was studying for a master's degree in Middle Eastern studies at Tel Aviv University. She savored being the knowing local for a moment, but no matter how many times she experienced it, this uniquely Israeli communal ritual continued to astound her. At exactly 11 a.m., Israel's national air raid siren system would fill the air with a loud, plaintive note, a blaring, high-pitched sound that could be heard everywhere, as if it were coming out of the air itself. For 2 minutes, the world would stop, as in a sci-fi movie. Cars would stop on the highways, their drivers standing like sentries next to them. In restaurants and hotels, schools and offices, stadiums and homes, everyone would stand in silence. Diners, waiters, and kitchen staff would all stand. Students and teachers in school would stand. Foreign news outlets would post videos of street scenes frozen in time while the jarring, inescapable wail filled the air. The sirens actually sound on 2 days each year, 1 week apart: Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Memorial Day, and Yom HaZikaron, Memorial Day for soldiers and victims of terror. 2 minutes was a long time to be still and silent. What or who were they all thinking about as they looked down, stared out, or closed their eyes? Wen wondered. If she hadn't been flat on a mat, she would have stood too. Participating made her in a small way feel part of the collective. But it wasn't just that Israelis were doing the same thing. They were tuned to the same channel, a channel she couldn't access. The channel was at once collective and personal, as Israelis focused on someone they lost: a brother, a son, a girlfriend, a parent, a childhood friend, a teacher, a student, a nearby shopkeeper, a soldier from their unit. Wen remembered another Memorial Day siren when she was Skyping from San Francisco with her boyfriend, who was in Israel. "We'll have to stop talking for a couple of minutes or so, but it's okay, just stay on." Wen marveled. He wasn't in public. He was in his apartment by himself, she told us. Nobody would notice what he did. Yet he stood up and had that moment. Joe McCormick felt a similar sense of awe. "The siren always sends chills down my back, even now," he said. "The name, the fair skin, the open face, the accent. These were all giveaways that McCormick was not a typical Israeli. Even for a place to which people had come from over 70 different countries, McCormick stood out. I remember the first time I heard the siren," he said. "It was on Holocaust Remembrance Day on a train to Haifa, and all of a sudden the train stops in the middle of nowhere. Fields all around, no buildings, and everyone in the train stood up. It was very intense. You could see on everyone's faces, their minds racing with emotions." "I grew up in rural Scotland," McCormick explained. "I'd never met a Jew. I was 9 years old when we learned about the Second World War and Hitler and what happened to the Jewish people. I remember the school and the teacher, and I remember being in that classroom and hearing the stories about how murderous people have been towards the Jews, and then fast-forwarding to this moment. I'm in Israel, standing in silence on a train with all these people whose country came into existence out of the ashes of the Holocaust." McCormick was one of the first people on Facebook when it opened to people outside of college campuses in 2006. That's where he met Adi, an Israeli who also was there to check out this buzzy social media startup. They got to know each other virtually for 6 months, and then McCormick decided to come for a 2-week visit. "I had no idea about the Middle East, less about Israel. I thought it was a place with camels and that Yasser Arafat was president," McCormick admitted. "I was so nervous. I was shocked at this big modern airport. It was nighttime, and I went to this cool and hopping city, Tel Aviv. I was like, wow, this is a lot different from Scotland." McCormick stayed with Adi's family. "It was a real Israeli household," he recalled. "A big family that would gather each week for Friday night dinner, 3, sometimes 4 generations getting together for dinner every week. I'd never experienced anything like it, and I just really loved the place." He quit his job and stayed for 3 months until his tourist visa ran out. McCormick went back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.